stole many a man's soul of faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt. Good evening, boys and ghouls. It's your podcast host of the most, the horror heathen. How are you doing on this fantastic Monday? Today, I have the absolute pleasure and a very special guest on my podcast and my YouTube channel. Her name is Sarah Lynn. You know her from The Haunting, not The Haunting. That was someone else. The Exorcism of Molly Hartley. So, I am so sorry. That was someone else in The Haunting. So, the beautiful and wonderful Sarah Lynn was born on July 22nd, 1982 in Regina, Saskatchewan, Canada. I have always wanted to go there. I've been to Halifax in Nova Scotia.
Not always wanted to go there. That can't
Okay, you're right. But I do want to go there one of these days.
All right. I mean, if you want, there's not a whole lot there.
You are an actress and director known for Edgemont from 2000, The Great Christmas Switch from 2021, The Humanity Bureau. I've never heard of that. So maybe we'll get to dive in that to some other time.
Yeah.
And you were married to Ty Runyon?
I was, no longer.
It was? Okay. The IMDb is not correct anymore. But you have won awards in the past. This is fantastic. I read your profile. You won a Leo Award for Best Supporting Performance by a Female in a Feature-Length Drama for A Simple Curve. Mm-hmm. In 2005, you also won another Leo Award for Youth or Children's Program or Series Best Performance for Edgemont for the episode Aptitudes. And again, in 2003, you were nominated for a Leo Award for Youth or Children's Program or Series Best Performance or Host for Edgemont for the episode Friday Night's All Right. And again, in 2001, you won a Leo Award for the same series, Best Performance for Edgemont for the episode Shall We Dance? Congratulations. That's awesome. That is a fantastic achievement for anyone. I'm working my way up to get awards somehow. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm going to do it.
Oh, thank you.
So can you tell us a little bit more about yourself that I had not said that you would like to tell the audience?
Sure. I've been acting since I was a kid in television and movies. Moved to Los Angeles 10 years ago and have been here since. I don't know. I don't know where to begin, where to end.
That's okay. I get it. I get it. It's fine. So you portray Molly Hartley in one of my all-time favorite exorcism / possession movies. I love the subgenre.
Oh, cool.
I love possessions. Exorcism. I think after watching The Exorcist, I was like 5 years old. I've gotten into it. And you did it so well. I mean, your performance is so paramount in that role. I mean, no, like I said, your role is so underrated and so unappreciated. And I tell people about your movie and they're like, what? I'm like, are you serious? You have not seen this movie? Are you kidding me?
But that's really nice to hear. It was really fun to do that because possession movies are like the scariest possible movie in my opinion. Like they scare me more than any other movie. So it was fun to actually do one.
Well, I agree with you 100%. I mean, they are the scariest ones. Now with all the makeup they put on you, is that you in the bed with all the makeup on and everything?
And that makeup took, I don't know, 5-6 hours to apply. It's a lot of work getting into that stuff. I mean, not so much. It's not a lot of work getting into it because someone does it for me. But those make for very, very long days on set.
Oh, I bet. I bet. So, how was the role given? I mean, did you audition for the role or was it given to you?
I did audition for it, and that's funny. I haven't thought about that in a long time. But I remember going in. And just, you know, you go in, you get a scene or two to act. Maybe there's only one scene for this audition. I'm not sure, but it was there was at least one scene and it was a possession scene. And I was like, you know, I like this stuff. I'm just going to go for it. Who cares? Like, because a trap you could fall into is like trying to do it right. you know? And I was just like, I mean, it's a possession. I'm going to do what I think is scary and fun. And basically, you know, The Exorcist is the ultimate of possession movies in mine and many other people's opinions. It's such a good movie. Anyway, I just went for it, and we finished the scene, and then the casting director and the director, Stephen R. Monroe, and myself, we just all burst out laughing. And he was like, I just loved it. That was amazing. And I was laughing. Good, thanks. See you later. And then when I went out in the room, the other girls were looking at me like, what just happened in there? What were those sounds?
That was me.
So it was pretty fun. It was nice that it worked out.
I totally understand, because I auditioned for as a scare actor at a haunt in Pennsylvania. And the very first thing that the guy in charge told me to do, I want you to act like a demented inchworm. What? I did it. I mean, I got on the floor and I started crawling around like an inchworm, you know. He's like, you got it. I was like, yes.
So then it's a good feeling, right?
It is. I didn't know you had to audition to be a scare actor at a haunt. That is so, so weird.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't know about that until I moved here, you know, for, what are they called? At Universal Studios, they have like a whole...
The Horror Nights, yeah. Halloween Horror Nights.
And people like line up around the block to audition for that. And it's very competitive. It's a very like popular thing to do. So I had no idea it was, you'd have to audition for that either.
Yeah, the one I did is called the Valley of Fear in Feasterville, Pennsylvania, and that's a very popular one too. So,
is it really scary? I mean,
from what I understand, is they upgraded it since last year.
Oh, okay.
So they added more attractions to it, and the role that I auditioned for was to work in the Terror Dome to be like a post-apocalyptic warrior. I was like, okay, I can do that, not a problem. Nice. I watched enough horror movies to do this, not a problem. Yeah. And then they moved me up to the butcher house, and we want you to be like a butcher. I'm like, okay, like a meat butcher. I'm like, I'll try. No promises, but I'll try. And then I developed this one character. I went to the Spirit Halloween store and bought a pig mask, I mean a burlap.
Nice.
And I named my character Porkchop. So And I developed this guy over the past few weeks I worked there, and people were so impressed with it. So
yeah,
I'm hoping that helps with my resume later on.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I digress, because I'm just, I could talk about this all day. I know you got somewhere to be. I'm so sorry.
No, okay.
At any point during the film, do you think any scenes were too arduous for you?
In Molly Hartley?
Yes.
Okay, it wouldn't normally have been, but there are some scenes where I'm running across the grass and sort of like through the grounds of the hospital. And that night was brutal, because it was, we shot it in Winnipeg in Canada. And they had like an outbreak of mosquitoes that was like once in a century style. So in the lights, like it looked like fog, but it was all mosquitoes, like just,
oh my goodness,
billions of mosquitoes all over the place. So you'd just be running through these clouds of bugs, and we're all completely covered in bites. And so that was a lot. But other than that, I mean, it was pretty physical, pretty demanding to do the actual possession stuff, but it was fun, you know. So, and you're lying, I was lying down for most of it too. So.
You had the easy part.
Scream and thrash around and make weird noises and be covered in slime.
Stocked up on a lifetime supply of calamine lotion for those mosquito bites.
Yeah,
exactly. Kid, I have I just watched the movie again for like the 18th time a couple days ago, because the scene where you're suspended upside down in the psych ward. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about how that was done, or is it like a film secret?
I don't remember. I'm guessing it would have been wires. Yeah, I'm guessing it was wires, but I don't remember.
Did you get lightheaded at least for doing it? I know I would have got lightheaded for a while.
Well, I learned on a different shoot that there's a limit to the amount of time you can spend suspended upside down before blood vessels in your face start to burst. So I came down once and was like, what are all these freckles all around my eyes? And they were like, you're wrapped for the day.
Sorry, we had you upside down for too long.
Yeah, yeah. So if you have any neurological issues. So I it probably wasn't very long, you know, just sort of like a quick thing, and then they do it back there. You know, usually on set, there's so many people overseeing all the safety elements. So
it's funny how Brian tells you any neurological, it's like, well, I am in a psych ward, people. Come on now. Okay, for those that had not seen the movie and who probably will after this, because I'm going to promote the hell out of this thing. Some people might get confused, like what the 6 year, the 6 month, and the 6 day means. I know what it means, but the audience, some of the audience may not know what that means. Could you like give like a quick brief description, or is this something like?
I mean, it's. I think it's just the number of the beast. You know, the most evil day possible.
Because it happens 6 years after graduation. You're 24 in the movie. You become partner in a law firm, and people are like, "Oh my god!" They're like. She's so successful.
Yeah, she had her like what is it, the Robert Johnson moment. She met the devil at the crossroads and made a deal. Maybe. I mean, I don't think I don't know that we ever like explicitly solved what the total backstory was, but one way or another, she got nabbed by what do they call them? Old Salty or whatever.
The Prince of Darkness. So are there any like behind the scenes secrets that people may not know about at any time of the film?
I don't know. I mean, one of the things is that when you're in that makeup, like it's scary in movies. It scares me in a movie. Anytime anyone's in that like ghouly makeup, I get super scared. But when you're on set, it's scary too. Like it's not CG, so like you really look like that. So it can be really alienating because no one wants to look at you because they're either scared or grossed out. So you're kind of just like, no one wants to talk to me. Like it's my first week at work, and everyone's just kind of like, you know, shuffle away. Which is just a funny thing that happens. And it makes sense, of course. But then again, it gets fun because you you know, start to play with it a bit. You've got like an audience, a live audience in a way to see if like what you're doing is scary enough. And there was one scene where the dolly grip afterwards was like, I had to leave. It was too much. It was too scary what you were doing. I had to walk off set. which felt really good because you don't know that you can necessarily like accomplish that in person. Oh, there's the dog. Hi, you want to say hi? Sorry, she just came home and she always gets excited to see me after the walk.
I got two dogs. I get it. I understand. So, yeah, it's just amazing. It's like you see yourself on screen. Like, God, was that really me?
Yeah, exactly. But then the people I worked with were like, "No, that was her. That was you." We worked with her for a week.
So working with Devon Sawa on set, what is he like?
He's great. I mean, that was a very long time ago. So, and that's the only time we worked together. But I like him a lot. He's a really funny guy, and he had I think his baby or one of his kids was like really new. So he was like a new dad. You know, I'd seen him in movies when I was a kid, which is exciting. And sometimes when we'd go out, a bunch of us went out to dinner one night and the waiter was like, "Oh, I just have to say, like, I love Casper so much." And he's like, yeah, I know. I've been in other movies too, you know, but which is pretty cute. But yeah, he was great. Works really, really hard, takes it really seriously, which is like what you want is just like a consummate professional to be working with. And he's absolutely that. Very generous guy.
There's one scene where he's on the hallway flicking the holy water. They do it like, I'm like, dude. It's like, wow, who slings holy water like that?
Yeah, he's an angsty priest, that one.
And it's funny how I think he's playing a priest in the Chucky series now. So, I think so.
Oh, cool.
It doesn't show his face in the in the preview, but I can tell by the voice, like, is that Devon Sawa? No.
Yeah, I've got to see some of that finally. Just keep missing it.
It's really good. I mean, the first season was great. I just started the second season, and I'm maybe two episodes in, so.
Nice.
No spoilers, I promise. Okay. So, as most movies do with exorcisms and possessions, were there any professional or religious experts on the set with you guys?
No, there weren't.
Really?
No. I'm sure that the writer, you know, did research and looked into some of the actual texts that are used and whatever. But it's also, you know, sometimes I think that exorcism movies are based on other exorcism movies. You know, I mean, I don't know how often exorcisms really happen in the world. Whether they're real or not, that's like, you know, different people have different opinions about it. But for us, for me and the director, we were using a lot of other film references, and he's a huge Kubrick fan, and he'd be like, there's going to be some point in this movie where I'm going to need you to give me the like Kubrick eyes, where you're like staring out from underneath your eyebrows. And
wait, hold on, let me see if I can do it.
But I watched a lot of videos on YouTube, because you know there's a bunch of like exorcisms online or whatever, and they are just so scary. Like, I don't even know if I believe. I don't think I do believe in it, but it still scares the wits out of me. So I was pretty spooked on that movie a lot, especially while I was doing my research and preparation.
And you're probably like, oh my god, do I really have to spit up like pea soup and stuff like that? Make my head spin, all that crap? No. No, 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 no.
Exactly.
Okay. Are there any upcoming movies or TV series that you are starting in anytime soon that I can tell the audience about?
Yes, A Wounded Fawn. It's going to be on Shudder December 1st, and I can't wait for people to see it. We just finished our festival run, which went really well. You know, I just say it all the time, but it isn't always true. I absolutely love this movie. I'm so proud of it. I'm so proud of Travis and Josh and everyone who worked on it. It's just, it's a unique movie, and I think people will really enjoy it.
And I'm sorry, what's it called again?
It's called A Wounded Fawn.
A Wounded Fawn, like
December 1st.
Like FAWN Fawn?
Yep.
Okay, and December 1st.
Mm-hmm. And there's a chance, I keep saying this, but it's not for sure yet, but I might do a live tweet, sort of like live watch tweet along on the 1st. So I'll keep everyone posted about that on my Twitter.
Cool. I'm definitely going to join in on that. That'd be awesome. Cool to see.
Yeah. I think you'll really like it.
Okay, that's all I have. Thank you so much for doing this. I really do appreciate it. You are such a fantastic actress. I really, that's just, I believe it. I believe.
Thank you so much. That really means a lot. It's really, really nice to hear.
You did so well in that part of Molly Hartley. It's just, it was fantastic. Anyone who doesn't believe it just can go get possessed themselves.
Amazing. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I really appreciated it, and it was really nice to meet you.
I just mean, I'm super thankful you took the time out of this, and I'm super glad. So, as a token of my appreciation, I would like to send you a South Jersey Horror Podcast T-shirt.
Oh, great. Okay. Let me see. I'll email you an address
and your shirt size.
And shirt size. You got it.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, but I do get orders from women who want the men's shirt because it's more comfortable. So,
yeah, I probably go with like a men's medium or large.
Okay, depending. Yeah, just if you like a PO box or something, or like somebody that I can send it to, and your shirt size, definitely. I'd be more than happy to put the order in next week and mail it out to you. So
Yeah, I'd love that. That's really, that's more than generous. Thank you.
Okay.
I'll ask another follow up. Okay, got it written down here. Awesome.
That's it. Boys and girls, the wonderful, the talented, the beautiful Sarah Land. Thank you so much for joining my podcast and my show. It's been an absolute pleasure talking to you and an honor. And I am super glad this happened.
Oh, man, me too. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that.
Thank you and have a wonderful evening.
Me too.